everybody. We are very happy to have the privilege to have a very special guest with us again. Because, as you probably know, it's not first time in Romania, it was first time at Romanian University. For introducing Professor Eftan, I'll ask Vlad to say a few words about him. I need just to express my gratitude for all of you, because you accepted to be here Friday evening at almost 7 p.m. Sorry for this delay in the program. And of course, I will express my gratitude for Professor Eftan and for his wife, because they accepted to turn back in Romania and to share with all of us from the experience. But,
thank you, Rector Pompus, for hosting us today, this evening. Thank you everyone for coming. Probably thank this institution, the Romanian American University, and thank our colleagues from the Mario Rothbard Center for helping us co-host together with Mises Institute of Romania and the Private Academy this event, and with our media partners. Let me very briefly introduce Professor Gene Eftan, and then give him the floor for a presentation concerning his intellectual journey, how he has become a libertarian. He joined Barron's in February 1992 as a commodities editor. The following year, he became the weekly's first economic editor and the first to write the column Economic Beat. Since October 2010, he has also been Barron's Book Review editor. He wrote a book, Econ Spinning. It's available online, and you can also borrow it from the Rothbard Center. How to Read Between the Lines When the Media Manipulate the Numbers. It was published in August 2006. Another important episode in his vita was before Barron's, when he was an economist, a senior economist at the New York Stock Exchange, where he worked for 13 years. He has also taught economics at the City University of New York and St. John's University, and he holds an MA in economics from the New School and a bachelor's degree in history from Brandeis University. He has appeared numerous times on Fox, CNBC, and BBC, and delivered talks over the years in many venues. As I have said yesterday, I'm always impressed to have the chance to hear someone speak, especially a fellow libertarian, and especially someone who met or corresponded or spoke over the phone with luminaries such as Mario Rothbard and Milton Friedman, or at least interesting guys such as Noam Chomsky. That having been said, I should just probably give him the floor. Thank you. The floor is yours.
Thank you, President Foucault. Thank you, Vlad. We're on a first name basis. I think I better stand. There is no mic here, and you should all hear me, and thank you so much for coming. I wish you a good Friday. The title of my talk is Mommy Was a Commie. It comes from a song that isn't so famous. It goes this way: if mommy is a commie, then you gotta turn her in. You know, and that was my mother. She was a commie, and meaning that specifically she was a card-carrying member of the Communist Party, and she had a deep influence on me. I reflect that she was Jewish, my father was Jewish. I'm Jewish. Although I was never bar mitzvahed, but beware the cultural Jews even more than the Jews who are bar mitzvahed. I believe that it's probably no coincidence that Trotsky was Jewish and so was Karl Marx. It's probably no coincidence that Ludwig von Mises was Jewish and so was Murray Rothbard. It's probably no coincidence that I am Jewish. What do we have in common? Well, thematically, it's especially appropriate this Easter weekend to speak of the concept of messianism. In other words, the Messiah will come and a new world will begin. And of course, Karl Marx was messianic, for sure. The communist utopia will evolve. I like to think that the messianism of the Austrian libertarians, such as myself, of Mises, of Hayek, of Rothbard, is rather more realistic. We recognize there will always be evil in the world. We recognize there will always be bad people. We don't hold out the prospect of utopia. What we do suggest, however, is that if you limit government, limit the authoritarianism of government, and allow freedom to flourish. And I should say that a main theme of my talk would be that political freedom, individual freedom, economic freedom, they're all one and inseparable. But if you allow freedom to flourish, then there is the maximum chance for material well-being on this planet, the maximum chance for people to lead exciting lives, creative lives, the maximum for output to double and triple. My mantra is there's no reason why the U.S. economy can't grow by 7% every year. If it grows by 7% every year, then it would double its output every 10 years, quadruple its output every 20 years. If the world, by the way, were a free market, then the entrepreneurial energies that would be unleashed globally would probably mean 10% growth would be normal. So that's the kind of better world that we are proposing, that we believe is possible if we remove the shackles of crony capitalism, and if we, of course, go further with what you've achieved in this country, which was to remove the shackles of socialism. And it dismays me in some of the things I've heard about the feeling about the history of Ceausescu, that one can talk about what I've learned from Vlad and others that had to do with shortages and problems and bread lunch and things of that sort. There may not be a sufficient understanding that even if Ceausescu were the nicest guy in the world, which I gather he was not, even if he had the best intentions in the world, it's impossible, as we free market people argue, it's impossible for one person to be running the economy or for a group of people to run the economy without market signals and without indeed entrepreneurs risking their capital, without a profit and loss system. And that was his fundamental error. Not that he was a bad guy, although, of course, as Friedrich Hayek wrote in the title of one of his chapters in The Road to Serfdom, the worst do get on top. The power-hungry do get on top. They seek power. And so usually it's compounded by the fact that the people at the top are hungry for the three drugs that power has to offer. There's power itself, there's money, and there's, if you'll pardon the expression, there's also sex. Sex, money, and power. That's what the powerful are pursuing in any society. And it's the duty of free people to limit those drugs, to make it, if they're pursuing those drugs, then what they've got to do is go into business and take their chances with the profit and loss system. But when you have somebody at the top who's just fumbling, who has no market signals, was just deciding, let's go into this enterprise, let's go into that enterprise, let's sell this, let's sell that. There's no losses. There's nothing that concentrates his mind about the risk that he's putting the economy to. And you're bound to have disaster. And that's what I've learned. Well, I want to start from the beginning. Mami was a kami, as indeed she was. We're going to begin with my intellectual history from 1944 to 1954. That was the year I was born, 1944. And that's my bout with Bolshevism. And it left a deep influence on my mind. My mother was, as I say, a card-carrying communist. My father was born poor, but he became a millionaire capitalist. My parents divorced when I was 7, and my father got custody of me and my brother after a 5-year struggle. Difficult for a man to get custody, but certainly it was possible because Mommy was a communist, because she was a member of the Communist Party, and that was greatly frowned upon in those days. But I, of course, your early years, you're more influenced by your mother than you are by your father. And I thought Joe Stalin was misunderstood. I thought he was a nice guy. But I did become a bleeding heart with compassion for the poor people of the world. I did, of course, adopt my mother's view that I thought, you know, of course, as a little kid, you know, black people were not only equal to white people. That was a big mantra of my mother. They were probably better than white people. That's what usually you do when you're an enthusiastic kid. You know, not only are they equal, mom, but they're even better than black people are. And so I sort of was raised with that view. And I had an idea about the winners and losers in society. The capitalists were always winning, and the socialists were always losing. And so I personified this with the baseball team. The Yankees didn't allow black people on their team, at least for a lot of years before the Dodgers and Giants did, if you know anything about baseball. And so they were the capitalist team, the Yankees. They always won. They only had white people on the team. The Giants and the Dodgers were the underdog. They were the socialist team. So the whole world was sort of colored for me in that way. And while, of course, all of these things are rather childish fantasies, your life gets lost in metaphors. There still was certainly, and continues to this day, an awareness on my part that there was a drama in the world taking place, and that the drama, of course, is between those who fight for a free society and those who fight against it. Well, we'll get over my bout with Bolshevism and go on to the next phase, which was my romance with democratic socialism. Now, that seemed to split the difference very well. That's when I was a teenager. It split the difference because, after all, you could still be a socialist, but you didn't have to approve of the Soviet Union. You know, Stalin was evil, as Irving Howe, if you know some of these names, Michael Harrington told me. But you could still be a socialist. You could be a democratic socialist. And Michael Harrington wrote a book, for example, called The Other America, which was a major bestseller among liberals and left-wingers. It influenced, greatly influenced, the so-called war on poverty. And there was a kind of a static view that Harrington took, and very much of a sort of a metaphorical view that everybody took about the progress of America. We looked at all the poverty in the 19th century, and we thought, well, my God, people are poor, and now everybody's better off, and Franklin D. Roosevelt has arisen, and there's more government control of the economy. So we sort of mindlessly associated with those things, that the progressives must have brought about the better economy. But the one thing that we never quite focused on, we socialists, of course, in those days, was that from 1870 to 1930, that's a 60-year period, unions were negligible in their power. Government in the United States did not influence labor markets. There was the rise of the progressives, but they were mostly all about fighting the trust. There was Theodore Roosevelt, the progressivism of fighting John D. Rockefeller and breaking up standard law. There was that sort of thing, yes. But to begin with, it's very dubious as to whether it really helped poor people. But apart from that, there was really no intervention into the labor markets. There was no Social Security, there was no minimum wage. All of the wonderful things that progressives say have rescued the working man didn't exist. And yet, from 1870 to 1930, that 60-year period, If you just look, and I, by the way, I want to insist that if you just look at the standard of living of the average person, it was a phenomenal increase, a phenomenal rise in the ordinary conditions of life of ordinary people. And by the way, I stress that because I firmly believe that the way economists tend to look at indexes of well-being is to get their lives confused by numbers. They look at nominal wages and then they bring in price indexes. And it's a whole rigmarole of numbers and argument, and all you have to do is just look at the goods and services, electricity, cars, radios, all of those tangible goods and services that ordinary people had in their lives. And then you have the whole story. Because really, the story of capitalism isn't so much on the wage side. It's really that wages sort of remain competitive, but that entrepreneurs make their fortunes by selling goods to the masses. And that's how incomes rise under capitalism. And so if you simply look at that 60-year period, it's a reasonable test case. How did we do it without the progressives? How did we do it without the intervention of government? Well, we did it because we had capitalism. And indeed, the concern over poverty in the 1960s, which was commendable concern, it was well-intentioned, but it also was so ignorant of the trends, so ignorant of the numbers. Poverty had been increasing rapidly. The actual specific numbers that even the government likes to use, from 1950 to 1965, the decline in poverty was palpable. Just the trend line in the decline in poverty, the well-being of black people, all of these things was rapidly improving in periods when we have data. But of course, we obviously know that the impoverishment of the 1870s, 1880s, despite the fact, by the way, that there was such huge waves of immigration coming into the country that one would think would have bid down wages. We all know, of course, that obviously there was no comparison between the way people lived in 1960 versus the way they lived in 1870, 1880, 1890. So it's just overwhelmingly the case that poverty was being conquered and that economic well-being was rising, and that we had so many extended instances in which government was not involved, it should have been obvious to anyone that we didn't, that the war on poverty, so to speak, I hate those metaphors of war, we use them far too much, but that the fight against poverty was being waged by capitalism, unaided, as I say, by government, certainly during the period from 1870 to 1930. So that's what I didn't realize in my phase two. That's what I didn't realize during my romance with democratic capitalism, or with democratic socialism. Let's get to phase three, because we're going to be moving quickly into certain my struggles with mainstream economics. Well, that's a little bit of a misnomer. It's really my struggles with Marxist and with mainstream economics, both. I went to the New School for Social Research, and it had a very strong, very powerful left-wing, basically it was a left-wing program. I became a writing assistant to a writer named Robert Heilbroner, who's been dead a number of years, but he was the best-selling economist in the world. He sold his books, including The World of Philosophers, that's where he made his fortune. He used to brag about his royalties, and understandably, anybody would, if you had that much money gushing in from your books. I, in fact, became his writing assistant on his textbook. And I used to say, well, I guess no man is a hero to his valet. And I'm his literary valet, and the guy is really not a hero to me. I thought he was, even then, rather empty in his views. But certainly, it was a serious-minded group at the New School, and we read Paul Sweezy's Theory of Capitalist Production, and we confronted things like the labor theory of value. And I think that a belief in the labor theory of value is sort of like divides, and I was speaking about metaphors, it divides those whose minds are lost in metaphors from those whose minds have something to do with reality. I mean, the idea, the compassionate, the idea that the content, the value of a good or service is a function of the labor, time, and effort that goes into it, is a metaphor. a metaphor that's potentially dangerous, although we do understand, of course, that obviously it's supposed to feed into the idea that this surplus value and that this exploitation of workers, and that's really the reason why it's positive. Although, of course, you'll find it's in Adam Smith, it's in, egregiously in the first couple of sentences of The Wealth of Nations, and it's been pointed out, of course, that in a way, Adam Smith was a precursor to Karl Marx. If you conjure it, it's almost as though, you know, if you get into the math and you start talking about how it can be translated into prices, you're sort of missing the forest for the trees. You're missing the obvious point that clearly it doesn't matter to any of us how much labor time went into producing a movie that we all find to be so boring that we might walk out on it after 5 minutes. You know, if I ever see a Marxist who believes in the labor theory of value walking out of a film, I might say, you just violated your own principle, sir. You know, a lot of work, a lot of labor went into that movie, and you think it's actually a bad, you know. Well, similarly, I lectured on Thomas Piketty's book last night, and I think that far from being a good book, it's a bad book. It's a bad book in the sense that it actually detracts from our understanding about the capitalist economy. So it clearly doesn't matter to me how much time and effort Piketty put in to producing that book. And by the way, it probably doesn't matter to Piketty either, since he made millions of dollars from selling that book anyway. But to me, the book is of no value. So clearly, no Marxist in his right mind who expounds, or no Smithian, or anybody who would even for a moment take seriously the labor theory of value could possibly live according to its precepts. We have things that are of great value to us. Mises' work is of enormous value to us. Or similarly, let's take necessities. I mean, you try telling an Orthodox Jew, if I may go back to playing the Jew card again, try telling an Orthodox Jew who keeps kosher that pork is of any value to him. No, it's treif. It's something he refuses to eat. It doesn't matter to him that there was a lot of labor and time that went into producing the pork and delivering it. So again, this theory, it reminds me, of course, those who expound the labor theory of value, if they give me, hopefully I'm not insulting anyone, it reminds me of George Orwell's line, he quoted a statement by an intellectual, only an intellectual could have said that no ordinary person could be that stupid. No. And that's what I would say about the labor theory of value. Only a profound economist can believe in it. No ordinary person could be that stupid. So I did get past the labor theory of value, even though it took me 5 times more energy and time than it possibly could, because of course then we got into the subtleties of how an educate, you know, your labor time is worth more, obviously, if you have a degree in engineering, because time went into that. But of course it's ridiculous, because we're not accounting for genius, we're not accounting for the fact that some people put very little effort and time into developing their skills. Some people are Picasso and the rest of us are not. You know, some people can write great novels and the rest of us can't. There's so many obvious problems with it, but as I say, the key problem is that nobody lives by it anyway. We all value certain things and we have no value on others, and the labor theory of value has nothing to do with it. So I did get past that one, the labor theory of value. But I had other obstacles to my thinking. The other one, of course, was the whole idea of monopoly. There was a book by Paul Baran and Sweezy. I don't know if any of these names are familiar to you. They're sort of like the left-wing people with whom I grew up. And they wrote a book called Monopoly Capital. And of course, we're supposed to believe, I also read Lenin's, I was in a seminar, I read Lenin's book on imperialism, all of those things. And we sort of took it for granted at the time that there was nothing competitive about the U.S. economy, and that it was basically ruled by a bunch of, you know, monopoly companies. So therefore, we might as well just nationalize all these companies, because after all, there's no competition in the U.S. economy. Well, there's lots of, you know, lots of things that can be said about that. I mean, certainly if you read John Kenneth Galbraith's book, another one, of course, was the another book that was, of course, a darling of the left wing, even though the left wing criticized his book. If you read the New Industrial State by John Kenneth Galbraith, you can see it was really a series of sort of non sequiturs. We could go into that, but it gets a little bit complex to explore what he was really saying. The key point to understand is that whatever else you might want to say about what was going on in the U.S. economy and its supposed monopoly, capital, ruling it in the 1950s and 1960s, we all know that at least historically that's pretty moot. All we have to do is say two words, General Motors. And that's sort of, and what should General Motors evoke in you? Well, in the 1950s and 1960s, you know, General Motors was, of course, the poster child, the poster corporation for monopoly, and then most recently, General Motors became the poster child for corporate welfare. Yeah. And so clearly, something is going on in the U.S. economy even if what Galbraith and the monopoly capital people were saying in the 1950s 60s, and 60s had any grain of truth to it, even then, we all know that it's pretty irrelevant today with the rise of global competition that makes it impossible, certainly, if you're producing a good that can be shipped, to possibly be a monopolist. And of course, on top of that, it's not just that goods can be shipped, it's that services can be shipped as well. And so the whole world clearly is a competitive global marketplace. But even then, something more needs to be said about the concept of monopoly. The real thing that needs to be said is something that's a little bit shocking, which is that competition consists of pursuing monopoly. So much of competition is really all about my trying to persuade you that there is only one Gene Epstein in the world, meaning that I'm trying to persuade my employer that I'm practically irreplaceable, that I have a monopoly on that thing called Gene Epstein Services. Similarly, Amazon, General Motors, all of those brands are trying to convince you that they're irreplaceable. They are trying to establish a monopoly. And that is what unleashes the entrepreneurial creativity of the economy. That's what unleashes my creativity. That's what I try to live up to being Gene Epstein to the limited extent that I can. Presumably did Barnes & Noble try to live up to being Barnes & Noble, to creating a brand, to doing things that were rather unique with bookstores, but somehow or other they were brought down by Amazon. Somehow or other those monopolies do not always last so long. Somehow or other, if you were to take a snapshot of the economy, certainly the U.S. economy with which I'm familiar, take a snapshot every 10 years, and you'll find that the companies that are on top were on top 10 years ago, somehow or other, are only a memory in people's minds today. Somehow or other, this so-called seeking of monopoly and achieving monopoly lasts even for a shorter time than some of us, even those of us who know this, that it's fiercely competitive, lasts a shorter time than any of us would imagine. And of course, as my friend Emil has taught me about Standard Oil, the way you survive as a monopoly is to do two things: keep your prices low, and keep your brand attractive. And if your prices go up, just for starters, if your prices get too high, then you're a target. Everybody notices you, and there's a lot of money out there on the sidelines that can start eating your lunch. An expression the entrepreneurs that I know love to talk about. They'll eat my lunch if I don't keep prices low and if I don't keep my brand competitive. And so that's what happened to Blockbuster Video. They were on every corner. They were defeated by Netflix. And then, of course, that's what happened. And of course, perhaps another leading indicator that a so-called monopoly is on its way out is when antitrust gets on them, as happened in the case of IBM. Somehow or other, IBM got defeated and displaced by Apple, Google, and Microsoft. And so we tend to think that these monopolies are going to last, but something happens, something changes. and the end and the end applies. And IBM is now, I know you work for them, my dear, but IBM is now only about one third the size of what it used to be, even though it's surviving. But it's clearly no longer the so-called monopoly that it used to be. Well, I spoke about corporate welfare, and that was the other part of a monopoly that I have to struggle with, which is the monopoly fostered by crony capitalism. Now, there we definitely do have a problem. There we definitely do have strong government. That we have the Ceausescu problem. We have the Obama problem. You know, that I forget the name of that solar enterprise that he was favoring. You know, when a president starts naming a company that he's going to send some subsidy to, and people cheer, then we know we've got a problem. And that's what happened with Obama. I'm forgetting the name of that.
Solyndra.
Thank you. So that does happen. Although, we should at least bear in mind that even crony capitalism can be defeated by real capitalism. A few examples. Uber is obviously an example. We have had in New York City a taxi medallion system that's essentially, of course, a crony capitalist system. You can't drive a cab in New York City unless you own a medallion, and the number of cabs are limited. Notoriously, these cabs did not pick up black people. And what's interesting is that it was on about 3 years ago, and you can maybe find out how naive I was. I was hailing a cab on 6th Avenue, and there was a black woman there, and I was asking her, are you about to hail a cab? You maybe want to share a cab? She said, I've been out here for 40 minutes, and none of the cabs are picking me up. She was a respectably dressed black woman, and she's a woman. My God, you know, she was the guys who were, you know, threatening. Why wouldn't they pick up? Well, I was told later, what do you think? Obviously, the cabbies were avoiding her because they didn't think they'd get a good return fare. They were suspicious about which neighborhood they'd have to take her to. Well, now Uber comes along and breaks that monopoly, and the government spots a monopoly. The great thing about Uber is they don't ask permission to enter a market, as many of you know. They just do it. And now the price of a medallion has plummeted to practically nothing when it was over $1 million. An incredible story about the takedown of crony capitalism. Or take another case, the U.S. postal monopoly. You know, as a matter of law, you know, you can't deliver a first-class letter. But obviously, do you know what's happening to the U.S. Post Office? They keep shedding workers. They don't have a viable business model anymore because they've been hemmed in by the forces of competition, FedEx, Google's Gmail. They can't make a living anymore, even though they're crony capitalists. One of the problems with crony capitalism is usually they get so fat and stupid because they don't know how to market anymore. All they know how to do is get checks in the mail. They often can be brought down by the capitalists. The other, of course, biggest story of the last 2 years, here I take pride in having anticipated it, is that somehow or other, OPEC is not functioning anymore. But that's the biggest crony capitalist system ever devised. Saudi Arabia was the swing producer. They were in control. And what happened? A bunch of puny wildcatters who know how to extract oil from shale suddenly start producing oil in the United States under the nose of Obama and all the others. And suddenly the price of oil collapses from $100 a barrel down to $35, $40 a barrel. So even then, let's understand that the American system is so filled with entrepreneurial energy that even the crony capitalists often get defeated. However, that doesn't mean, of course, that we support crony capitalism. It only means that, inevitably, if more people became enlightened, they would boo Obama when he talks about Solyndra. They would boo any politician for favoring one company over another and thinking that he can pick winners and losers. And if enough people boo, then we can probably put a stop to crony capitalism. Well, I got past all of those issues, but I had some other issues as well. And now I'm going to get to pay phase four. This is a rather sloppy history. That's 1974 to the present. My life as a bleeding heart capitalist, libertarian
an Austrian economist, the life I've been living since 1974. The real struggle I had, and what broke the logjam for me, having to do with socialism and capitalism, was actually not my bleeding heart. Bleeding heart came later. It's funny when you think about how people think about your own intellectual history. If you made a change, then you probably find that there are just moments when, you know, when suddenly the dam breaks, you know, the water starts to drop. And then you haven't figured, you know, when I was talking to a couple of my professor colleague friends the other night, they were talking about a systematic understanding of Austrian economics is important. I was thinking of my own background and thinking that, I'm just a person, and I didn't develop in a systematic way. There's just certain things became so untenable that I suddenly became rapidly open to other things. And this is what became untenable for me, having to do with my affection for the very well-intended democratic socialists that I knew. And that includes, I guess, perhaps, again, names that maybe are not familiar to you, Irving Howe, Michael Harrington, others. They really did care about civil rights. And by the American Civil Liberties Union really does care about civil rights and freedom of speech. And yet, they tend to be very left-wing. I thought, well, my gosh, if they're living, you could be both left-wing and a libertarian. You could be a libertarian socialist, which is what, of course, Noam Chomsky calls himself, a libertarian socialist. It wasn't until I read just a few things that made me realize how foolish that was. The logjam was broken. I began to realize the obvious point that in order to exercise freedom of the press and freedom of speech, you need access to the means of production. You need access to printing presses. You need access to lecture halls. You need access. By the way, you need your own labor to be freed up. You can't be an employee of the state. You have to allow the state to fire you, to give you independence, so you can earn your own way. All of those things are necessary. It became clear to me that economic and political freedom are essentially inseparable. Ironically, by the way, I had read Milton Friedman's book, Capitalism and Freedom, in which he made that argument. And then there was a refutation in a socialist magazine called Dissent of that view. Friedman made the argument that that communists could push their views under capitalism because they could get access to printing presses, they could go into business, they could sell their stuff, but capitalists could not get freedom of the press under communism, because obviously whatever communism is defined as, and I know that people like Noam Chomsky like to think of communism as everybody owns the means of production, and that's fine. There's no real state. Maybe there's just a workers' council. Whatever you want to say. Clearly, if it's socialism, it basically means there is no private ownership and no private control of the means of production. Well, if there is none, then even the best-intentioned socialism is going to go bankrupt if it starts telling everybody. In fact, I used to talk to certain young colleagues of mine who would say, well, you know, if you want to publish a book, then, you know, a socialist economy would just say, yeah, of course you can. You know, we just have a bunch of nice people who say, yes, publish. Well, what if you want 1 million copies of your book published? Then what? You can't have 1 million copies of your book. Well, what if you're going to say that I think 1 million of my copies of my book can be published? Can you rent me some printing presses so I can turn out a few? Can I establish a bookstore? Can I advertise it online? Can I go into business and do it? Clearly, the socialist economy, if it cares at all about freedom and freedom of the press, is going to have to say yes. Ergo, capitalism rears its ugly head, so to speak. Ergo, you cannot conceive even of the best functioning socialism as one in which freedom, real freedom of the press can happen without ready access to your own labor, to the printing presses, to the stores, to capitalism, where the means of production are possible. And this was, by the way, during the Vietnam War that I began to realize this, and of course began to realize that it was only under capitalism that somebody like Noam Chomsky could publish. Only under capitalism that these things were possible. Although, again, I would insist to those who point out fascist countries that are sort of capitalist, repressive countries that are capitalist, more precisely, capitalism is necessary, although not sufficient, to freedom of the press. But it's necessary. In other words, you can have the most benign socialism in the world, and unless you have capitalism, you're not really going to have freedom of the press, because you're going to deny people private access to the means of production. Although, of course, you can have capitalism, and if you have a repressive government that's going to throw you in prison for publishing anything they don't like, then of course you're not going to have freedom either. But once that occurred to me, then other things occurred to me as well, and that included something else, which of course actually is in many books. You can read about it in The Machinery of Freedom by David Friedman, for example. And the other thing, obviously, is this, that socialism is always possible, communism is always possible. Of course, it was plain as the nose on anybody's face in the 1960s and 1970s, people were going to the country forming communes. They were becoming communists, and of course, the U.S. had a long history of communities and utopian experiments of all kinds. And, you know, God bless them, let 100 flowers bloom. They were buying their own property, and they were, you know, they ran according to the principle of democracy. Most of them obviously did not work out very well. But in addition, if you just write up a blueprint, do you want the workers to own all the companies in the U.S.? Very easy. You know, just first of all, get the unions behind it. Let's form an organization. Let's boycott a series of companies. And when we boycott those companies, we'll drive them into bankruptcy, then we'll buy them up on the cheap and we'll own them. And then when I propose this to people like Chomsky or other radicals, they say, oh, well, you know, that's very tough to bring about. You know, you have to bring them, you have to get boots on the ground, you have to have takeovers, you have to boycott them, you have to live as hippies for a while in order to bring about these revolutions. And of course, the thing that I would say to them was, well, you imagine the socialist revolution as possible. You have all kinds of great, ambitious, revolutionary ideas, and all I'm talking about is sort of a boilerplate takeover of companies with worker control, and you think that's not possible? That's a lot easier than what you think could be brought about. The fact that nobody does it probably indicates that nobody wants to do it, that some of us actually don't mind being wage earners, that it more or less reflects what people want. But by the way, I don't think history stops. Maybe the capitalism of the future is going to be, you know, worker-owned enterprises. Maybe that's what will happen 100 years from now. Maybe everybody will want more control over his workplace and all the rest of it. Although, when I was at the New York Stock Exchange as a senior economist, I used to write about this a lot, amazingly they let me do it. And I used to go to the conferences of the worker ownership movements and basically support their dreams and their goals. And there was always, by the way, a company that had gone bankrupt, that had been bought by the union. There was always a darling company. It was always the company of the year that they were very excited about. And usually it ended up in sour conditions, partly because, of course, democracy sucks. You know, democracy is an evil, a necessary evil. That, you know, it's the right of, as you'll excuse the expression, as a friend of mine said, 51% of the people's right to piss in the soup of the other 49%. I mean, there's absolutely nothing good about democracy. Democracy is simply an expedient. It's a necessary evil at times, but by and large, we want freedom. By and large, we don't want anybody to have to vote about whether you're going to attend this lecture tonight. You just want to do it. You want to live your life. Your right to move your fist stops at somebody else's chin, but beyond that, just stay out of everybody's way and let them do their thing, and let's not take things to a 51% vote. And that, of course, was the vision of the founding fathers, the vision of the Constitution, a limited government with no democracy. So that's part of the reason why I became I became sour on the idea, but I realized that, any socialist, any communist who wants to bring about this society can do it, either to a limited extent or to a great extent, depending upon how many people support it. And again, the idea that there's not enough money to do this with is a little bit ridiculous. You know, it reminds me of a petition that was published in the New York Times on the Upper East Side when a bookstore was went out of business because the rent got too high, and it was signed by about 30 millionaires, including Woody Allen. They protested this bookstore being closed. It never occurred to these 30 millionaires, or however many there were, to kick in a few bucks and support the store themselves. You know, again, the abdication of personal responsibility on the progressives, on the part of the progressives, is sometimes sort of mind-boggling about what they, their complete indifference to recognizing that maybe they can make a difference if they didn't want this bookstore to go out of business. You pay the rent. You know, it's a, you know, if you don't think it should go out of business. So again, those who want socialism can have it if they want. While I had romantic views about democracy in the workplace for a long time, I overcame it because I began to recognize that that if you, for example, are part of a co-op or a condominium in a building, you'll occasionally say, "Well, I pray for a landlord building." No, because what happens in a co-op, as perhaps some of you know, is there are usually a few fanatics with time on their hands who pretty much run the show, who turn it into an insane place. A landlord who basically just wants to do business and wants to keep everybody happy and keep the customers there is usually a better solution to running a building than a crazy co-op is. You can read, of course, about co-op follies. I could tell you stories all day about the co-op that my wife and I live in. So again, you know, community living sucks, usually does. What's the final phase? I'm going to get to that. There's that 19th century saying, the man who was not a socialist at 20 is a scoundrel. The man who remains a socialist at 40 is a fool. We're going to talk about that. It's not my view. I should have not been a socialist at 20, and I would not have been a scoundrel because I am a bleeding heart. And we can get into the reason for why capitalism lifts the living standards of the broad masses of people, why it naturally does, why unions actually get in the way. They create more problems than they solve. And maybe we will get into it. But hopefully I've maybe provoked a little bit of controversy among some of you. And please, no holds barred. Please, I'm used to being insulted. Probably what I should have done is, I have a very active email correspondence. And when you write with a strong voice as a columnist, as I do, and you write for what is called a kick-ass publication, Barron's, as I do, you would be amazed at the insulting email that you get. And so I'm used to it. In fact, who knows, maybe I like it. Part of the reason why I like it is that what I normally do when I'm told what an idiot I am and what a jerk and how I've distorted reality and how I was probably born with a silver spoon in my mouth and whatever else they can say about me, I always respond with complete politeness. And I usually begin by picking up on the one thing that this critic said that maybe is valid. And I always begin, "You are, of course, quite right to point out that I'm Jewish," you know, or whatever else. So therefore, I start with a positive, and then I politely criticize. And you know what I get in response? Usually the most abject apology. "You're so polite, and I insulted you so badly. So therefore, please insult me, and I'll be polite back." So if any questions, I have some other things to present, but so much has been thrown out, such a smorgasbord of cockamamie ideas. Now, if you have some objection to what I have to say, then please speak up. And tell us why you think I don't know what I'm talking about. Yes. Oh, you. Yes, you are.
I'm sorry.
No. Camille comes last. Is there anybody else who?
Freedom of speech.
No. Freedom of speech. But I'm the capitalist here. It's fine. Jane, he's fine. No. Did you have something to say? Because you have less access. to me.
James, so you know, one thing I have to tell you, as a baseball lover, you almost missed the thing that was the most important thing to a baseball game.
Yeah.
You know, which practically disappeared because of Monopoly. You know, a national anthem was these buts for you.
Oh.
Right? Budweiser, you know, controlled 90% of the market and disappeared completely because every week you had 2-3 micro breweries that was coming into the picture.
Well, the control, by the way, I have to respect, I have to correct your language. When I, you know, I control 100% of the market for King Neptune services. On the other hand, that doesn't mean a heck of a lot. Because somebody can replace me. So, you know, nobody controls a market, you know, unless, you know, you just be sold 90%, and consumers could just decide anytime to buy some other product. But thank you for that contribution. And did we have another contribution from this gentleman?
I wanted, first of all, say that for me, Robert Heilbronner was important because it's exactly because of all the philosophers that I decided to become an economist.
Wow,
so,
okay. You made some money from you then.
yeah, definitely.
You told me I got a $10,000 in the check in the mail, he said, and that was just for 6 months worth of work. So you contributed to that, and that's good. Go ahead.
Yeah. What I wanted maybe to insert a sort of historical perspective,
yeah.
Because in a country like Romania, to discuss about socialism or capitalism,
mm-hmm.
We cannot forget the fact that there was the so-called percentages agreement during the war.
Percentages?
Percentages agreement.
Percentages.
Yeah, between the West and Stalin. And actually, because why it's important, these countries in this part of the world became a part of this experiment due to this agreement. So they were kingdoms, some of them, they were republics, some of them, but they were market economies. And they did not decide by vote or any other means to become socialist, but as a result of this agreement. So. Of course, some intellectuals could discuss about one system or another, but for the societies and economies as such, it was not an option. So this is an element that it is important in the sense that it was not a choice.
Sounds like a tragedy, but go ahead. Yes.
That was a fact. And the final comment was the fact that that Marx had one important aspect regarding value. He said that value became a reality when the goods are sold in the market. So if you are not selling them, there is no value in
right.
just producing them.
Yes.
So this includes the market in the discussion, if you want. Because if people don't buy them, if we do not have the act of buy and sell, then the value is not realized.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
This is an important element in, let's say, understanding that theory, which refers to the 19th century, the labor value.
Well, okay. Certainly, if it's sold in the marketplace, offered for sale in the marketplace, then the profit and loss system will determine whether anybody places any value on it. And by the way, there are most new products fail. Most new films, most new books, they fail. They're bought by virtually no one. And so we find that the judgment of the marketplace is that they had virtually no value. And if everyone, of course, went kosher tomorrow, then pork would suddenly have no value. So I'm only trying to emphasize that. By the way, I gather that Marx never actually used the term labor theory of value. I gather, at least not in Germany, but certainly that was implicit. That it was the labor time that went into it, and I'm only saying that that's pure nonsense on Marx's part. That it's again the delusions of a brilliant economist who could only think in stupid ways is what I would suggest to you. If nobody wants to buy it, then it has no value. So I assume you and I agree about that.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Anybody else? Another question, challenge? Yes.
I think you should include Kodak in your list
oh,
of
yes.
examples that
yes.
failed miserably.
Yes.
It was
yeah.
basically monopoly almost yes. anywhere if the market is good.
Mm-hmm.
And then now they just do some industrial mm-hmm. lines and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And that would be solved.
Yes.
They didn't invest in, for example, digital technology and digital photography, and that looks like the future and is now. And they just failed. They lost the battle.
Yes, that's an interesting example. As a matter of fact, I was told, your Kodak was based in Rochester, and I was told that actually there's a fair amount of entrepreneurship that still is in Rochester, partly due to the fact that for Kodak employees, the people who actually were the creative ends of Kodak, are still doing entrepreneurial things. But of course, you're quite right about the Kodak example. And that actually is a primary, almost applies a primary rule of business. The best example of Kodak's failure, which is that the basic failure is that you won't cannibalize your own business. That a company that's a sort of bureaucratic commitment to the way it markets its product and to what it does, and it will be left to competitors really to do it differently, because usually the culture is so ingrained in the way these things are done. And that there's a sort of special interest group that forms within that culture. And the most dramatic example is actually, at least in my mind, is actually the Oxford Encyclopedia, which was sold door to door by salespeople. And while those who ran the encyclopedia recognized that the wave of the future was selling the encyclopedia online, in order for them to go that route, they had to destroy the livelihood of their sales force. And they didn't do that. So other encyclopedias stole the march in them, and of course these days we all look up on Wikipedia anyway. And so that indeed is usually what happens. Usually the reason why those certain monopolies just become undone. A&P, a grocery chain, is another good example. They were in the cities, and they pretty much had that business model. They were basically destroyed by suburbanization. The combination of suburbanization, station wagons, and freezers, and large refrigerators, and so they were not ready to recognize that huge amounts of food could be bought by Americans, could be put in the cars, and could be stored in refrigerators and freezers for long periods, so they were not present in the suburbs, and they didn't recognize that was the way of the future. And so, really, so much of American economic history really is characterized by monopolies being in charge for a while and then falling by the wayside. But again, I emphasize that the real key to point out is that the pursuit of monopoly is in a way what competition is all about. That putting your mind around that apparent paradox is the important point. And the pursuit of monopoly is usually a combination of price and quality. For Walmart, it's all about price. For Walmart, it's all about recognizing that first of all, you're going to sell name brand goods and serve goods. But most of them are going to be, many of them at least, going to be made in China. And then you're going to be able to discount severely. And because they're made in China, you're going to be able to dictate to the manufacturing base that they've got to meet certain standards and deliver at certain prices. And that becomes your business model. And Walmart is probably the best single anti-poverty institution of the last 30 to 40 years. That's where poor people go to buy their goods and services. Walmart. That's where they buy their gasoline, which is also amazing. I guess I'll proceed pick up on economics, which is the that one of the gateway drugs to recognizing that capitalism is vital to society is to recognize not just that it's necessary to freedom, but that it's necessary to lifting the living standards of the broad masses of people. That essential to lifting the living standards of the broad masses of people. I'm going to pick up on the formulation of an economist named George Riesman, whom I've been discussing with a couple of colleagues. I think he puts it very well when he explains this. This is a key quote from Riesman about wages and how they're determined in the free market. He writes, the Marxian explanation that the alleged arbitrary power of employers over wages appears plausible because there are two obvious facts that it relies on, worker need and employer greed. Those are facts. As he says, worker need, as he elaborates, the average worker must work in order to live, and he must find work fairly quickly because his savings cannot sustain him for long. And if necessary, if he had no alternative, he would be willing to work for as little as minimum subsistence. So all that's true. It's indeed a reason why, you know, if you go, go on the Upper West Side of Manhattan, you ask people, where would wages be if there were no unions, if there was no government pension, no living wage movement? They would all say, well, you know, subsistence, because after all, the worker has to work, you know, he doesn't have a whole lot of savings. He would be willing to work for subsistence. Now, of course, he's got to get subsistence, otherwise they're not going to show up to work. Better to die under a tree than if they're not going to pay your subsistence, then why even show up? But they got to pay your subsistence so you can get to work and have enough energy to put in the work. But clearly, there is greed on the part of those bosses, those employers. Self-interest makes employers, like any other buyers, prefer to pay less rather than more, to pay lower wages rather than higher wages. All of that is true as well. So we would say, and in the catechism of the left wing, that with employer greed and with worker need, then obviously, unless you have unions, unless you have government intervention, workers would get subsistence. And that's the logic of the argument based upon facts. Facts that are indisputable about employer greed and worker need. But he asks you, gives you, I think, an instructive example to recognize why that isn't the case at all. And he gives you the parable of the car seller. You move to a big city, New York City is a good example where I live, and you can't afford to maintain your car because there's no parking. You want to sell your car, but you move to the city. And indeed, the car is now such a liability because you're going to take the subway. The car is such a liability, you actually pay somebody to take it off your hands. Because you know you can't, you're gonna have to pay to garage it. You'll get tickets. There's no place to park it. So you gotta get rid of it, decide to sell it. Now, you have a case of severe need, just like a worker, severe need to get rid of this car. In addition, you've got a lot of greedy people out there who want to take it off your hands for nothing. Who want to be paid to take it off your hands. So you face need and greed, just like the average worker does. But the question is that really what's going to happen? Are you going to be that dumb? You'll just look up in Craigslist and you'll sell the car for a price. Because in a reasonably competitive market, greed and need are not the issue. In a reasonably competitive market, people are going to pay you pretty much in accordance with what that car is worth to them in New York or in the suburbs or wherever else you want to. Of course, you might not sell it in New York, you might sell it in the suburbs where cars are more valuable, but that's only about a 30-minute drive. Obviously, need and greed are not going to be determinative in that case. So, similarly, in a competitive marketplace, buyers and employers want to pay the lowest price, the lowest wage, but that price, the wage, must be high enough to outbid any other buyer or employer. And obviously, workers in any urban area, any metropolitan area, they have hundreds of employers to whom they can go. And we have information that supports them. So therefore, worker greed and employer need are not crucial to determining wages. And further, to elaborate, corrective mechanisms are that a powerful employer cannot depress labor prices below the value of workers' financial contributions for long because other firms are attracted by the cheaper labor. The new firms hire these workers and thereby put upward pressure on the prices paid to labor until further profit from the initial exploitation of isolated workers disappears. That's from a very good piece by a labor economist named Morgan Reynolds about labor unions. If employer clout suppresses wage rates in one location, labor supply will decrease as mobile workers leave, again putting corrective pressure on wage rates. And further, even the historical image of corporate power dominating isolated company mining towns is mostly fiction. 19th century Appalachian coal miners, for example, were highly mobile, and literally hundreds of companies competed in the same coal and labor markets in both company-owned and independent towns. But of course, basically, we no longer have that sort of problem, and we might elaborate the point that labor is the most versatile and flexible input, so it is much harder for owners of large fixed capital investments to exploit labor than for labor unions to exploit business investors. Further, what does a labor union do? It fosters inequality in two ways. Wage advantages enjoyed by union members result from two factors. A union does indeed raise wages, but by creating this monopoly and preventing other workers from applying for the jobs, the monopoly unions raise wages above competitive levels, and then the non-union wages fall because workers priced out of jobs by high union wages move into the non-union sector and bid down wages there. Thus, some of the gains in union members become at the expense of those who must shift to lower paying or less desirable jobs or go unemployed. Well, interestingly, that's really just part of the story about what this living standards of the broad masses of people, because in that case, we're just talking about how the wage doesn't fall, about how in a competitive marketplace, wages are sustained. But now, interestingly, the best tribute to the power of entrepreneurship comes from Karl Marx. At least one of the most eloquent tributes that I know of, this is from the manifesto that he wrote, "The bourgeoisie, by the rapid improvement of all instruments of production, by the immensely facilitated means of communication, draws all, even the most barbarian nations, into civilization. The cheap prices of its commodities are the heavy artillery with which it batters down all Chinese walls, with which it forces the barbarians' intensely obstinate hatred of foreigners to capitulate." He further elaborates, "The bourgeoisie has subjected the country to the rule of the towns. It has created enormous cities, has greatly increased the urban population as compared with the rural, and has thus rescued a considerable part of the population from the idiocy of rural life." Interestingly, Karl Marx was no fan of living in the country. He was speaking about the idiocy of rural life, but realized that when he was talking about, in that case, the rise in living standards coming from cheap prices, that virtually all the great fortunes in the U.S. are made by selling goods and services to the masses, the real point is that wages are sustained by competitive levels, but what happens is, of course, that Henry Ford, Steve Jobs, Rockefeller, all of them basically innovate, make fortunes, and sell goods and services to the masses, and that's what lifts the living standards of the broad masses of people. What maintains, what gives the purchasing power is that wages are competitive, and that's the dynamic by which the living standards of the broad masses of people rise. So that, you know, rising productivity on the farm drives workers from the farm to the factory, rising productivity in the factory drives workers from the factory to the office. And so an update of that saying is, the man who was not a socialist at 20 understands that socialism brings impoverishment and tyranny. He sees free market capitalism as the only system known to man that can bring both prosperity and freedom. I ask you to join me in supporting free market capitalism. Probably run out of time, so I had a couple of other things to say about Noam Chomsky. Probably, he's just a, please do, okay. Well, talk about Noam Chomsky. In there, as part of my intellectual development, I came of age during the Vietnam War, and I was a draftable. And I attended Chomsky's lecture, and the first lecture in 1965, and then I read his book, American Power and the New Mandarins, and I found it blew my mind, because Chomsky had a particular formulation about American foreign policy. He wasn't just talking about the conventional idea that America was an imperialist nation. He did believe that, and I think he made a cogent case that that was the case. He was also pointing out a couple of other things. That, first of all, it wasn't about economics. It wasn't about Lenin's view that was essentially difficult and impossible to support, that that wars are about economics. Specifically about economics in the sense that everybody benefits from waging a war. He pointed out that clearly the only people who do benefit from waging a war are the elites. The elites generally, at least certainly not in the modern age, do they have to go off and fight that war. The companies that sell military hardware to the government, they're not sacrificing. The taxpayer is paying for that military hardware. So that the mantra, the myth perpetrated by people like Henry Kissinger, that we're spending all this blood and treasure on helping you, that we're such good people. Well, we have to disaggregate. Once again, we have to use some methodological individualism, which is the term for that the Austrians use, which is to recognize that the vast majority of people don't benefit from the imperialist war waged by their government. The vast majority of people pay for that war, first of all in money, but of course, by the way, the money that is used to pay for it is usually printed. It does not usually come from taxes. That, in fact, I mean, the history of money basically is that the government takes over the printing of money because it's the easiest way to pay for wars, and that's essentially why we have central banks, why we have government getting so interested in controlling the money supply, because it doesn't like to borrow, it doesn't like to tax, it likes to print, and that's what finances it. But in addition, of course, they play with their treasure. And so his point was, it made me recognize that it was possible both to be a free market capitalist as well as to understand that my government was imperialist. Because there were so many people stuck in the idea that the only way to believe your government is imperialist is to be a socialist, is to believe. But of course, obviously, the military-industrial complex is all about crony capitalism. It's all about government-supported, it's all about Dick Cheney, who was vice president of the United States, as you probably recall, but who had been, prior to that, a defense secretary, and he gets a job as CEO of Halliburton, not because he has any managerial experience, but because he's got ties with the Pentagon. And so this sort of unholy alliance is recognized by capitalist libertarians as yet another depredation of the state. It's not a manifestation, as Lenin would argue, of free market capitalism actually applying. And I mean, obviously, there's so many other fallacies about that. Clearly, we'd have to ask, why was Russia imperialist? How is it possible? But literally, by the way, I was taking a course in imperialism by a guy named Harry Magdoff, who worked with Paul Sweezy, and he literally believed that Russia could not possibly be imperialist because it was a socialist country. That it's not possible for a socialist country to have any need to be imperialist. But obviously, it's all about sex, money, and power. It's all about, because people like Henry Kissinger assuring us, this, of course, was also a number of striking comments that Chomsky made about the new Mandarins who pushed war. Henry Kissinger used to say, and I heard him say this once, in fact, he was quoted, used to say that it saddened him that anybody questioned our motives. It greatly saddened this man that anybody questioned our motives. And as Chomsky said, you know, this is perhaps, this guy's a PhD in political science, and he's saying, you should never question a government's motives. You know, that we alone in the world never question America's motives. Of course, we used to, any sophisticated political scientist, of course, is used to questioning the motives of any other government. You know, clearly, there's the propaganda, and then there's the actions. But Kissinger is pushing the idea that we should never question our motives. And the new Mandarins that Chomsky was talking about were not just Kissinger, not just PhDs like him, but a whole slew of people who were the new intellectuals, who were filled with the excitement about running the world. There's a guy named Ithiel de Solopoul, who's a PhD from MIT, George Bundy, all of the new intellectuals. And then this is something Chomsky wrote when I was still in my socialist phase that really wrote me up short. He wrote that that Avril Harriman, he said, believes that he has a right to run the world because his grandfather owned railroads. He said, I think it was McGeorge Bundy was the example. He said, McGeorge Bundy thinks he has a right to run the world because he's smart. He said, and between the two Mandarins, I prefer Avril Harriman, he said. And he said, the reason I prefer Avril Harriman is, he said, if Avril Harriman is wrong, he's not going to be defensive. Because, after all, his grandfather still ran railroads, so he still has a right to run the world, he said. But the new Mandarins, the new intellectuals, if they're wrong, then they sound a little stupid. And then they begin to lose their right to run the world, so they get more and more defensive about what goes on. And they become more difficult. And not that I want any of these Mandarins to run the world, but I prefer Harriman. So again, he's coming. I thought, my God, he's coming after the son of the capitalists. He prefers these capitalists to run the world than he prefers the intellectuals. And that really did bring me up short, and it prepared me for my bout with economics, recognizing that if you look, because I thought, my God, PhDs, intellectuals, they're all, you know, they're moral people. I had the naive idea that they too were not seeking sex, money, and power like so many other power-hungry people. I began to realize that when I studied economics, that Chomsky's formulation as applied to the mainstream, we talk about having conversations with people. I did have the privilege of being able to talk to Milton Friedman every few months. I had one funny conversation with Murray Rothbard, but I had a memorable conversation with Paul Samuelson. And Samuelson was telling me all he wanted to talk about was one of the funny things is that I called him because there was something in his textbook that I didn't think he possibly believed. And I'm trying to remember what it was, but in any case, it was so clear that his textbook had been taken over by somebody named William Nordhaus, who was his collaborator, and Samson hadn't read the textbook in years. He said, I have to check to see if it's in there. He hadn't read it, because he was just, you know, floating on the profits. But all that Samson wanted to tell me about was his heady days with John F. Kennedy. That he was just bragging to me about how he told Kennedy to do this and told Kennedy to do that. Again, the excitement of these people that when they sit at the tables of power. And it made me realize that not just is economics handicapped by a love of mathematics, by the idea that economics is all about mathematics. And as I say, if economics is all about mathematics, then you will never, ever understand why the labor theory of value is nonsense. Because you can mathematize the labor theory of value endlessly. It's only if you think about human action, and if you only think about why you walked out in that movie that is of no value to you, that you can understand why it's nonsense. That's, of course, their desire to make it sound esoteric, just like the way the new Mandarins did in political science. Because Chomsky used to ask, Chomsky, by the way, is a PhD in linguistics, as you probably know, and no formal training in foreign policy. But he used to ask, he said, I'm told that, that I'm not supposed to say anything about foreign policy because I don't have any, I'm supposed a degree in the field. He said, I'd like to know, what is this special expertise that these guys have? Could they send me their theories? What is it that they know that the rest of us don't know that entitles them to run the world and entitles them to tell us that we have no right to criticize what they're doing? But in economics, of course, they like to believe that it's all about mathematics so that they can have this magical, pristine pursuit that's removed from us all. And then, of course, they want to sit at the tables of power. Imagine Alan Greenspan's career. He's a lowly, he doesn't even get his PhD, he's got a forecasting firm, he's struggling along, and then Greenspan's trajectory is fascinating because he has an essay called Gold and Economic Freedom when he was an objectivist involved with Ayn Rand, which the first paragraph, I think it was probably written by Ayn Rand and not by him, because it has a sort of this fiery language that echoes Karl Marx about how the powers that be are tremble at the thought of gold, because they recognize that gold brings economic freedom. And then he then goes into a reasonably cogent discussion of what essentially Austrian business cycle theory, of why the central bank, he specifically says, the central bank causes more harm than good. It exacerbates business cycles, is what he specifically says in that article. So then Greenspan is 40 years old, not especially young, 40 years old, and he publishes that fiery article. At the age of 48, he's chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors under Gerald Ford, and then I forget however many years later, he takes over from Volcker to become chairman of the Federal Reserve. And when Ron Paul, who you may have heard of, he was a libertarian politician, he encountered Greenspan with a copy of that article, Gold and Economic Freedom, and he, as a joke, I guess he asked Greenspan if he'd sign it. And so Greenspan fluently signed it. And then Ron Paul said, I imagine you repudiate it all today, known as chairman of the Federal Reserve. And Greenspan said, oh, no, I read it just last week. It really holds up. It still holds up. I would have said to Ron Paul, if you had another moment with the man, you might have asked him, it really holds up. Can I read you that passage in which it says the central bank causes more problems than it solves, that it's part of the problem, not part of the solution? And amazingly, Greenspan forgot all that part of it. And Greenspan's trajectory is pretty much where economics has gone. They love to sit at the tables of power, and so they celebrate power. They never question the idea that maybe the central bank causes more harm than good. Maybe the central bank was really a crony capitalist conspiracy of banksters, as I think it really was, as history shows it was, if you actually explore the history of the central bank. And so that's the long-winded explanation of how Chomsky affected me. Chomsky prepared me, ironically, to, and I say ironically because you probably know what Chomsky's economic beliefs are. But almost everything I said this evening, Chomsky would be shocked by. Because Chomsky still writes sensible things about American foreign policy, but he still calls himself a libertarian socialist, and he still writes some amazingly obtuse things about economics. But still, I believe, has a deep insight about American policy in the world, which of course is a different subject altogether, although one that greatly interests me as a libertarian. So that's Chomsky, that's my development. The final moment in my story is, of course, that a few months ago, my wife and I had a chance to travel to Moscow and St. Petersburg, where I spoke, the land that my mother used to celebrate. She was increasingly unsettled by many of the things that the Soviet Union did. She said, some of the things that communists do make me recoil, she said. But then she did fall back on a mantra. She began to say, would the Soviet Union be doing this if there weren't good reason for it? She used to hold on to that idea. And was that echoed, of course, right-wingers in my country who basically believe that the US government would not be doing these things if there weren't good reason for it. No. So my government, right or wrong. But my mother transferred this to Soviet communism. But after the fall of communism in 1989, 1990, I remember had a big argument with her, and she began to give ground. She began to feel, people used to tell me, look, your mom is well into her 80s. You're gonna try to take her religion away from her? Is that nice? Is that kind? Well, Jews are like that. You probably know. They can't give up on an argument. And so my mother began to abandon her views. Although she did used to say to me, but you believe in worker ownership, don't you? You believe? He said, yeah, you know, I'm a little less enthusiastic than I used to be about it. But still, you know, I think I can imagine it could be the way of the future. More enterprises, capitalist enterprises. I believe in capitalism, but of course, it's fine with me if workers want to own enterprises, and maybe that would be a better way to go, control and own them. But my mother died in 2007. She didn't live to see me go to Moscow, go to Russia, and Moscow and St. Petersburg. I spoke at the Moscow Center about bleeding heart capitalism with a bunch of Russians, because I told them, you know, I'm a red diaper baby. I feel like this is a homecoming. Apart from anything else, my grandfather migrated from Russia with Byelorussia, Minsk. Thank God for the Tsar, because otherwise my grandfather would not have migrated. I would have been stuck in the Soviet Union. And I spoke about free market capitalism. I was told that this was at the Moscow Center, which was financed by the U.S. And I was told by the director there that the wind was blowing in the direction of closing down these cultural centers, that the unfortunate enmity between Russia and the United States was beginning to bite, and this center financed by the Americans was, who knows, perhaps its days were numbered. After my talk, maybe it's not coincidental, but 3 days later the center was shut down. But at least I got a chance to speak in Moscow about my mother's ideas and about the possibilities of freedom in the world. Thanks very much. We have some time. Any other person want to make some comments, please?
Yes, I have a question about Greenspan.
Yeah.
I remember reading that his PhD is very difficult to find.
Oh, yeah?
And that at some point somebody found a copy of it.
Yeah.
and it is about how housing bubble can develop.
Is that right? Really?
Yeah. I don't know. I was asking.
He's not the person that found it.
No, I didn't know. I know he got his, I'm trying to remember, he got his PhD very late. I mean, he probably didn't write it himself. He probably hired a couple people to do it for him. But because he, I mean, I believe he was probably, it was after he became chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors that he got his degree. But it's that's a good, that's fascinating. And I'm going to look at to see what his dissertation was really all about. Indeed, he was, he and Bernanke, Ben Bernanke, of course, was also Fed governor at the time. That housing bubble was forming, and they really tried to cover their tracks. I mean, with the most amazing snow job about what was going on. That indeed there was that the housing bubble was formed by a savings glut, and in fact there's no evidence that there was any kind of savings glut. They blamed it on the savings glut. I mean, for Greenspan, of course, to have gone from having been the walk on water chairman to having been the chairman who effectively presided over the worst recession since the Great Depression, was an enormously devastating come down for the man. Bernanke, again, was also a Fed governor at the time. Bernanke literally delivered a talk in which he cited an article in which he said that this academic study shows that the Federal Reserve had nothing to do with the housing bubble. The amazing thing about doing this in the age of the internet is that you can easily access the article. You don't have to just go to the library. With John Taylor, an economist who's criticizing Greenspan and Bernanke, alerted me to this. I looked up the article. The article said exactly the opposite of what Bernanke was claiming. It made it very explicit that the Federal Reserve policy was behind the bubble. So Bernanke had the audacity, as a supposed scholar, to cite an article as supporting him that actually literally contradicted him. So again, if you read so many of these people, I'll mention Paul Krugman, for example. Again, and so much of what Krugman writes, and not infrequently what Greenspan says, what Bernanke says, it doesn't even make good nonsense. It doesn't even make good nonsense if you actually begin to unravel what he's saying, the contradictions, the inconsistencies. Krugman, of course, leaves such a trail because he writes a column twice a week. And so, he lives each day as though it were his first. You wonder if he remembers what he said last week, because it's really however the mood approaches him, and that it's amazing what he gets away with. When Krugman, by the way, Krugman was on a story I like about him was when he actually got a little jocular and honest, was he was interviewed by a reporter on a sort of a slightly comedic show. And the reporter said, "Look, you're a Nobel Prize winner in economics. If anybody criticizes you, you can just pull rank, right? You can just say, hey, I won the Nobel Prize. You can't disagree with me." And so Krugman smiled and he said, "Well, the problem with saying that is that some of the Nobel Prize winners in economics are a bunch of idiots," he said. Now, I would have said to Krugman, the interviewer then said to him, "Could you name some of those idiots?" And now Krugman should have included himself. He didn't. But then he actually said, "I think I shouldn't." Academicians, I think, do not these academicians, but academicians do a sort of a minuet courtesy with each other. You don't want to impugn other academicians. And so he didn't. But at least, he admitted some of it. We want Camille to make a statement.
Greenspan, at the end of his life, he gave up on free markets. I saw the article in the interview.
All that. Oh, yes. No, that's good. My progressive friends are constantly citing Greenspan's statements that my model, he says, my model about the free markets was flawed, he said. And so because they regard him as the ultimate wise man, so when Greenspan is asked, well, why did it all happen? He said, well, I had a flawed model about the free market. My flawed model about the free market was I thought that the financiers would be more, more responsible about financing housing. And so my model was flawed. And so indeed, I've given up. This was his main confession. And of course, this has been cited by, umpteen million left-wingers, and they don't see through it the way I might, having been trained by Chomsky. The man is just covering his tracks. What else is he going to say? He should say, I was maintaining interest rates at 1%. way below where interstate should have been. I was cheering on variable rate mortgages. He literally did. He appeared at a mortgage conference and he said, you should issue more variable rate mortgages. If you read the minutes of all the FOMC meetings, they were all concerned about how well the housing market was doing. If you read the minutes going into 07, 08, they were clueless about the housing bubble. And of course, obviously, if the Federal Reserve that supposedly has all this information is clueless, what do you expect the average trader to be all about? And of course, obviously, Greenspan ignored the fact that Clinton and then Bush, through Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, were pushing affordable housing. They had the mantra that they wanted wanted the home ownership to go up to 70% from 64%. They wanted more and more people who couldn't afford these mortgages to buy them. That was basically a government-sponsored bubble. And obviously, if you're Angelo Mozilla, a private sector guy, and you're issuing these mortgages that are going to fail, what's it to you if you can sell these mortgages to Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, government-sponsored enterprises? And so Greenspan completely covered up the fact that this was essentially a bubble that he was clearly mostly an accomplice. There were some saving grace moments where he made statements that Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, which again were government-sponsored enterprises under the authority of HUD, a government Department of Housing, who were being told to buy more and more subprime mortgages. He was criticizing them in moments, but by and large, 90% of what he did was to foster the bubble. Foster the bubble both through his policies and his statements and his example. And then he cries that, oh my God, it's the free market that failed me. And progressives are naive enough to believe that statement, because it's the statement that gives him the maximum potential to get himself off the hook about what he did and what he helped cause.
Just out of curiosity, since it is election year and we've been talking about presidents, how would you feel that America would fare economically and otherwise under the leadership of Donald Trump?
Well, since he's asked me to become his chairman of Council of Economic, no, I'm kidding. I believe that it's almost impossible to answer that question. When we talk about, you know, Krugman living each day as though it was first, you know, it, not remember what he said from one day to the next. Maybe the easiest example to choose would be to talk about George W. Bush, who ran on a non-interventionist platform, who said, we can't do nation building. And then what does he do? He uses 9/11 as an excuse to invade Iraq. We're used to politicians saying one thing and doing the exact opposite. Obama was going to close Guantanamo.
Yeah.
When it comes to Trump, we know. Obviously, I'd get a little nervous if we were in charge, but I might even be more nervous about Hillary Clinton. By the way. But certainly, I would only want to have to duck that question only because I don't know. I don't know what the Trump of 3 months from now is going to sound like. He'll probably become a little bit more serious. He'll probably become a little bit more conventional in his views, and probably be not as nutty as he sounds. I admit that, of course, it may be a sorry commentary on many libertarians like myself, that with part of me, we get pleasure from seeing Trump win these elections. And it's a very destructive, very shameful aspect of libertarian thought that we just like the way the Republican Party is getting turned upside down. We like the way the wheels are coming off the conservative model. We like the way Trump says they lied their way into the Iraqi war. And he says the most inflammatory things, and he keeps winning elections. Nothing can stop him. And also, of course, it sort of is an gives the message, I think, to those who rhapsodize about democracy, that the average voter is so nuts that you really do want to limit, you just want to limit the power of government. You don't want anybody, somebody in the White House having the sort of power that Obama or Hillary Clinton would have, or that George George W. Bush had, because clearly the people who get in power are a little nuts, and they're often put in power by people, by ordinary people who are themselves a little nuts. But the fact that it's been such an irrational drive with Trump, and that the Republican Party is so upset about it, actually warms the hearts of Republicans, and it's not, warms the hearts rather of libertarians, and it's nothing of which I'm especially proud, because clearly when Trump says, yeah, they lied their way into Iraq, but then he says, I want to send a lot of foot soldiers to start kicking ass in this country or that country, he clearly, again, contradicts himself from 1 minute to the next. Even though, by the way, even though Trump is indeed a protectionist, it's very sad that that the average person is feeling threatened by workers from abroad. It's very sad that he's listening to Bernie Sanders as well. Sanders and Trump are both saying the same things. The Chinese are stealing our jobs. That kind of populism, that kind of xenophobia, hatred of foreigners who steal our jobs, that's obviously tragic that they're preying on those thoughts. In my view, international trade benefits poor people more than it benefits anybody. Walmart is the poster child for international trade. They collect goods from abroad, they sell them cheap, and Trump and Bernie Sanders trade on that. Although certainly Obama is guilty of making statements of that sort too. When he was campaigning against Romney, we libertarians were joking that the choice was between Rambama and they had the same name. What was it?
Omni.
I've ruined that joke, so I won't go. But they sat in the assembly when Obama was saying that he kept cheap Chinese tires out of the country. You know, that those cheap Chinese tires was clearly a threat to the average working man who would have to buy those cheap tires. And then Romney was embarrassed by that, and he too had to say, instead of having the guts to say, you like cheap goods kept out of this country, Mr. Obama? This is good for the average person. The average guy who buys a car should pay for more expensive goods, for more expensive tires. This is what Obama was saying. So he too sounds like a protectionist. And Hillary Clinton wanted to finance the Export-Import Bank. She was proud of having financed the Export-Import Bank, which is another crony capitalist institution as well. And amazingly, Bernie Sanders said, that's crony capitalism. So amazingly, they sometimes switch from one position to the next. It's very difficult to keep up with these people and their foolishness. But another long-winded answer to a very good question.
I'm a professor, so I have three questions.
Oh, okay.
First, I have to observe that next time you come, I have to adjust my observation that you met or were in connection with Chomsky, Rothbard, Friedman. Now I have to add Heilbronner.
Dropping a lot of names.
So my first question would be, those guys at the new school, like Heilbronner himself, Baran, Sweezy, and the others, Galbraith, you yourself, when you were there, do they actually read the bourgeois economics? I don't know. Mill, Adam Smith, Ricardo, Robbins, Hayek, Mises, Spencer, whatever, Menger. Do they actually honestly read the theory of the free market in their best expositions?
Well, truthfully, the only person I knew fairly well was Heilbronner. I went to his house, I was like his protege, and he helped, he helped me get some good jobs even though I didn't have a PhD. So I knew him well. There's others, Galbraith, I read him, accounted him, he was an odious personality. All the progressives, even progressive people hated him, because he was, his ego could fill the room. But I doubt very much that Galbraith Galbraith, I think, was completely illiterate as a classical economist. But I have to say that that Heilbronner certainly had read them. But I believe that Heilbronner, and I will say about the worldly philosophers that essentially it's not an intellectual effort, because essentially it says that all of these economists have something interesting to say, and they can't all be right. It was a sort of a stunt, and that was pretty much Heilbronner's sensibility. It may be difficult to believe that he could have read all these people and yet sort of not You know, and yet for him, you know, economics was sort of like literature. He couldn't quite take the ideas seriously or sort them out completely. And so his was a kind of a you know, if you read some of his essays, we could explore them. I mean, his essay on socialism, for example, in which he actually believed that, I'm going to mention something perhaps as a term, he believed that the socialist calculation debate had more or less been won by the socialists, you know. And so his fuzzy thinking was, got me, even then, got me rather upset. So therefore, I mean, that's the best answer I could give you. That the amazing thing is, people who sort of think of intellectual works as works of literature and think of them as stories and yet don't put them together intellectually. Is seemingly what he was able to do.
And then you also mentioned a few of the bad guys, a few of the good guys.
Samuelson?
Maybe you can mention a few of the good guys in your life.
He didn't mention anything about Rothbard. So
yeah. A few of the good guys intellectually, like Rothbard.
One particular good guy certainly include George Weisman. I quote him. But for me, another key moment for me was when I was teaching economics in college and getting increasingly bored with the subject. I happened to pick up Man, Economy, and State in the New School library, and I was only dimly aware of Rothbard. I was an inveterate browser and said Man, Economy, and State. I remember picking up the book two or three times and looking at it a little bit and putting it back. And maybe the fourth time I picked it up and started reading it. And that was also, I left that out because in a way it's about my development in economic theory, which gets a little esoteric. But the key thing about Man, Economy, and State for me, which launched me as an Austrian economist, was that it not only had a systematic view of economics, but it had many digressions in it in which he lambasted the mainstream economists. I already suspected that there was something wrong with the mainstream economics, but I didn't see any substitute, anything else that was viable. And so I was sort of at sea. Maybe I was getting to be sort of an anti-intellectual, that there could be such a thing as economics. But for example, I've been hung up on this idea of monopolistic competition that was expounded by Samuelson. And I began to realize this problem. The monopolistic competitor, in Samuelson's view, is a clear example would be Joe's Barbershop. And in fact, Samuelson used the example of a barbershop in his textbook. Joe's Barbershop is a monopoly because there's only one Joe, but it's a barbershop, so therefore it's also competitive. And Samuelson argued, and the curves that he drew showed you, that a monopolistic competitor must be operating with excess capacity. So it was an indictment of capitalism that the monopolistic competitor like Joe's Barbershop is anathema because there's so much excess capacity in what he does. Interestingly, the key sentence that stuck out for me was when Samuelson wrote, the chairs in the barbershop are empty much of the time. And then even then it occurred to me that Samuelson probably took his haircuts during the week because he had an academic schedule and he didn't go to the barbershop on weekends. He didn't realize that what Joe had to deal with was peak demand versus the fall off in demand. If he'd gone to the barbershop on weekends the way I used to, he'd find that there was a waiting time to get a haircut. And so that I realized was Professor Samuelson's mistake, but why it was such a foolish example based on his personal experience, not realizing the problem of peak and trough demand. But then it was Rothbard who went after him, and Rothbard who explained that it was all in the way he was drawing his curves, all in the way that you could draw the demand curve and the cost curve in a couple of different ways, and he was no longer operating with excess capacity. Because then Rothbard, of course, the emperor had no clothes once again. It was just so foolish, because Rothbard quoted another economist who said, "We're to believe that a bunch of capitalists are so foolish to spend money on excess capacity. What are they wasting their money on excess capacity for? Why are they collectively so stupid?" And indeed, this was almost self-evident, but it was when Rothbard showed you that it was all the way curves were drawn that it made such a difference. Now, that sounds like a trivial example, but it was really that, again, how the logjam breaks, how you began to realize the foolishness of what you've been learning that's supposedly so learned. And then you understand that economics is all about human action. So that was key in my mind. And of course, I haunted the laissez-faire bookshop, as it was called. It was on Mercer Street downtown, and it was open. It was a bricks and mortar bookshop in those days. I went there almost every Saturday to buy a couple of books. I read Rothbard, I read Hayek, I read most of Ludwig von Mises. And so indeed, my heroes, my intellectual heroes in economics are, of course, Rothbard, Mises, to some degree Hayek, to some degree George Wiesman, all of them very much influenced by Mises. I then, in fact, Rothbard was teaching at Brooklyn Polytechnic Institute in Brooklyn, and I barged into one of his classes, and foolishly I didn't ask him if I could audit. I asked him a question, but he was, you know, how do I walk in there? So we didn't have a especially pleasant exchange, I asked him. And then it was a number of years later, when I was writing my column for Barron's, just starting out pretty much, and Gary Becker, University of Chicago economist, had just won the Nobel Prize. And Rothbard, I gather he maintained the great scandal of those libertarians is so many of them kept rent-controlled apartments in New York. He maintained his rent-controlled apartment in New York, but he was living in Las Vegas because he was teaching at the University of Las Vegas. So I got him on the phone and I asked him, what do you think about Gary Becker winning the Nobel Prize, Professor Rothbard? So he said with his inimitable squeaky voice and nasally voice, he said that politely at first. I think it's a nice, you know, it's great that an economist with a free market orientation is winning such an award. And then I asked, what do you think of Becker's theory that a family is like a firm? Becker had written these articles showing that with curves and mathematics, a family is like a firm. And Rothbard said with his, again, his signature voice, he said, I think it's nuts, he said. And indeed, it was. Not, so I said, yeah, probably, Professor Rothbard, you and I could find more fruitful economic theory and arguing that a firm is like a family. Because after all, it's got its bosses, it's got its brothers and sisters, but it's got sibling rivalry. All of this being metaphor, obviously there's an analogy between the family and being like a firm, but it was kind of trivial. Anyway, that's my only encounter with Rothbard. Otherwise, I heard him speak a couple of times in person, but I knew him through his writings. And Rothbard, to me, certainly, he was sort of like, you know, Socrates, he was Plato to Mises and Socrates. Mises was an accomplished writer in English for having been somebody who wrote German.
Have you ever heard Mises live in some conferences?
You know, I have never had in the recordings, yeah. And then you have Mises, yeah. You've heard him in the recordings? You've heard him in the recordings, yeah?
No.
Yeah, no, I never encountered, no, indeed. Ludwig von Mises died in 1974, and he had a seminar, a free seminar that Rothbard attended. For them, of course, the fortunes of life, again, if it had not been for Adolf Hitler, Mises would not have fled Germany to Switzerland, and then never fled Switzerland to New York, and he brought Austrian economics to New York, and then there were a bunch of people, George Wiesman, Murray Rothbard, who were getting their degree from Columbia University, who attended Mises' regular seminar. And they of course talked about that. But Mises died in 74, so I missed it. And I never actually, as I say, never had personal encounters with Rothbard that were very important. But again, I've read virtually all his writings. And he's a very lucid writer, right? Very down home. I love his recordings, his signature giggle. He obviously had a lot of joy in life. And I listened to many of his lectures. So among the heroes, of course, for me, Rothbard is certainly one of them. Wiesman, George Wiesman, another. His book Capitalism, a lot of very clear explications of economics. And certainly, there's some fantastic. I believe Mises is a little harder going. He was a German writer. He didn't start writing in English until the age of 59. Very accomplished writer in English, given those handicaps. And certainly, his books repay the effort. And are worth reading, but a little less accessible than Rothbard is, for example.
Like a good professor, I forgot my third question.
Okay. Yes.
What kind of libertarian are you? So what's the specific branch?
What specific branch?
Yeah, deontological, libertarian.
Well, let's see, Communist Libertarian. Well, you might say, for example, that I don't remember. I was about to say, is there anything that Ron Paul has said that makes me a bit unsettled? I mean, Ron Paul, as you know, is a religious man. He was a gynecologist, and so his issues with abortion. Ron Paul wanted the states to determine abortion. It was as a libertarian, I'm a little bit more. I think a woman owns her own body, and so on. So that's but otherwise, virtually anything that Ron Paul has said about American foreign policy, about economics, I would agree with. So I mean, if you want to categorize me as a libertarian, I could say I'm a Ron Paul libertarian, but that helps.
Anarchist?
I mean, anarchist. Well, that's a good question. The answer is I respect anarchists, and that I figure let's achieve the minarchist state. Let's go back to the night watchman state envisioned by the founding fathers, and then we can talk about it. I certainly think the anarchists. I have a lot of interesting points to make. The most crucial point they make, to my mind, is that if you believe in government, you should believe in world government, because clearly we have anarchy in the world. We have basically about 160 gangs in the world, with the U.S. as the principal mafioso, and they get into some very dangerous fights. And so, therefore, I think it's a contradiction for those who believe in the state to believe that there should be 160 states, because that really breeds violent anarchy, as we all know. What is it? I read just the other day that governments, I guess, over the last 100 years, have been responsible for about 260 million deaths, both by deaths of their own citizens and deaths of people abroad. So I have a lot of respect for the anarchists, but probably I don't have enough of haven't thought about it enough or have enough of an intellectual capacity to appreciate them completely. So I'm ambivalent between the night watchman state and anarchism. I certainly do believe the Federal Reserve should be abolished. That's really a divide between certain free market people and other libertarians about the Federal Reserve. I mean, Milton Friedman really didn't believe that the Federal Reserve should be abolished. He believed it should be reined in. But certainly I think it was a bad idea, the Federal Reserve. So that helps define me in economic terms. And I certainly believe the night watchman state, at least, maybe anarcho-capitalism, but certain things about those arguments do unsettle me. So hopefully that helps.
Yeah. And also, what's your view on immigration, given the current context? So not taking away the states and how the world is at the moment.
Well, there too. I believe that. I mean, certainly, if you have a welfare state, you have a problem with immigration. But certainly, if we set aside the problems of the welfare state, that when people move, they become stakeholders. Certainly, I'm impressed by the arguments. Perhaps you're familiar with them, of Ben Powell and others. That if we allowed free immigration and we allowed all the poor people of the world to move to sectors of the world where there's a lot of capital invested, we could double the output of the world. Of course, we'd need flexible wage rates in order to do that. And so, certainly, I do also believe with other Austrians that there is such a thing as private property, and there is such a thing as trespass, that you shouldn't come on my property. But I believe that probably would be moot, because clearly, if employers would simply say, come on my property and work for me, you're cheap labor, and if there were no barriers to entry, no rules against immigration, there would most likely and even with property rights completely imposed, and people saying, well, don't come on my property if you're an immigrant, there would probably be so many entrepreneurs and so many other property owners who would see benefits in having these immigrants that the property rights objection would be moot, and that there would be massive immigration allowed. Which, of course, obviously I would support. It would be capitalist acts between consenting adults. And clearly, that's how my grandparents came to this country, on both sides. They came and they worked, and they started businesses, and they became productive people. And certainly, I believe a purely libertarian economy would invite them in. You're contributing. You're getting a job. And so I mentioned that only because there are some libertarians who have these strong objections, Herman Hoppe, who argues about trespass, but I believe his objections are moot, and that while he's right as far as it goes, the vast majority of property owners and entrepreneurs would welcome immigrants, would see economic advantages in having them work
for us and work with us, and so there would be free and open immigration in the libertarian world.
Well, I can say from the things
sure.
we could be helpful. So my view about what you said about your view on economics and that's what I'm trying to say is that you are although you mentioned that 95% from economic science is within American and state, you're still called high and so on. So I think Gineppism is more Hayekian than other.
Oh my God. That's the worst insult that can come from this man.
So this is my
Murray Rothbard once said with a giggle in his voice that Ludwig von Mises once called him a Schmollerite. And he said that's the worst insult you could have gotten from Mises. The Schmoller was some institutionalist who he hated. You are a Schmoller. So you're going to be high. Really?
They
so,
have a good advice.
Well, what have I said that's so Hayekian? First of all, Rothbard thought that some of Hayek's essays were very insightful. He had some praise for some of Hayek's essays.
Yeah.
So what's Hayekian and what I've said?
We just discussed about that.
Okay.
The formation of price and the distinction between information argument and calculation. So I just want to mention for
it is just too hard to understand.
Okay, a little esoteric, but I've just been insulted by my good friend.
Well, Rothbard called Mises the extreme right of the left.
The only non-socialist member of the left.
Who was that?
That was Rothbard's joke about Mises in the seminar.
No,
that Professor Mises is the only non-socialist member of the left.
Well, certainly I would say...
Due to his views on the state.
Yes. I do believe that you have to be a non-interventionist to be a libertarian, that libertarians do believe by the way, I would say that if the U.S. were a libertarian country and there were evil in the world, I would favor nonprofits that might be answerable to me and to my charitable contributions. To right some of those wrongs in the world. It's not like I want to see evil in the world. It's not like I want to see the slaughter in Rwanda. But I do believe that if you have a government trying to right wrongs in the world, it's overwhelmingly likely to do more harm than good. And so and I believe the US government policy in the world has done far more harm than good, because it tends to be, it will be favored by elites, bureaucracies, by opportunists, by power-hungry people. And so even though it might do some good, on balance it will do harm. So that's why, as a libertarian, I object to the activist US foreign policy. But as I say, it's not like I'm indifferent to all the atrocities that go on in the world. I would want to right some of them very possibly. So I believe that in order to be a libertarian, you must have that position. And I also do believe that in order to be an Austrian libertarian economist, you basically have to understand that that control of money is perhaps the worst thing the government could do. As I've joked, I would prefer that they run the shoe business than that they run the money business, because they got involved with money primarily to fight their wars, and their involvement with money causes business cycles. It's the first thing that governments want to control is money, and I believe that's a much greater evil than controlling any other kind of business, and it causes much greater damage. And so that's a key aspect of my beliefs. And of course, there are people who are free market who don't question the central bank. And they believe it's got harm, it's got flaws, it has to be improved, it has to be reformed, all of that. But they don't understand that this is the fox guarding the chicken coop, that when government controls the money supply through the Federal Reserve or in any other way, it does immense harm, both in terms of fighting the wars and in terms of the economy. So I believe that those are the two key aspects of libertarianism. Beyond that, I believe that libertarians can have disagreements about many things, even between Hayek and Rothbard, but possibly my friend here disagreed.
Sir, do you believe the American intervention in the Second World War II was it appropriate or not?
In Japan, yes. In Europe, certainly we wouldn't have had to fight World War II had we been a little less opportunistic about World War I. But certainly.
Let's go back to.
But I do believe that in Japan it was simply that we obviously did more harm than good. We killed more people than we saved by trying to unseat the Japanese attempt to establish an empire in China.
So I think at least we got a yes, right?
Excuse me? The answer is no for World War II in the Pacific Theater. The answer as well is that if the Federal Reserve had not been formed in 1913, we probably would not have fought World War I. And had we not fought World War I, we would not have created the conditions for Hitler to take control, and we would not have had to fight World War II. So it's a partial yes, because clearly Hitler, by 1939, 1940, was such a menace that clearly there was a reason to fight World War II. But we created that reason through World War I, and through the Federal Reserve, by the way. And that's a key point that libertarians have to make, because that financed the war, the creation of the Federal Reserve in 1913. So it's a mixed answer. Now, even that war, now obviously, I don't know if there's any war since World War II that I can defend the U.S. has fought. But that's of course, another long story. I think that most, that by and large, we've done some good, but we've done an immense amount of harm in the world. The harm is way up, has offset the good. By the way, you could say that of almost any other foreign policy. But many other countries have done some good in the world.
One of the big mistakes was Marshall Plan. Right?
I'm sorry?
One of the big mistakes was Marshall Plan. Right?
Is that, are you baiting me? You think the Marshall Plan mattered? you're quite mistaken about the Marshall Plan.
A tough dealer follows.
Okay,
maybe
okay.
One last question.
Okay.
It's already late. Last question.
Well, I was thinking, you can skip it, but I was continuing on the question about immigration. Well, if you have a huge welfare state, what do you do about immigration?
Well, of course, obviously you can't. I mean, that's part of the reason why countries with huge welfare states obviously have their dark side, because they recognize that these people are stakeholders and they have to become marginalized or driven out or not even allowed in to begin with. That's why the U.S. had such a fantastic immigration policy around 1900, 1910, because it didn't have a welfare state. But certainly, as if you're talking about second and third best solutions, then I imagine you and I would grasp that if you give an immense choice, you come here but you're not a stakeholder, that 90% of what a stakeholder would get in terms of welfare, if we do have a welfare state, will be denied you. Do you want to come here anyway? I imagine Amir would say yes.
Absolutely.
So therefore it's your deal. You chose this deal. You're not entitled to the welfare state. Do you want to come anyway? Well, in the case of the U.S., we'd probably get about 10 million takers anyway. But that's the only solution, only possibility. But I admit that it creates some potential problems, but at least I think it's a workable solution to give them that deal if they want it.
Would you still pay the same taxes without getting the benefits?
Well, we're getting into the nitty-gritty, I guess. probably if we offered them the same deal, you pay the same taxes with no benefits, no checks, no unemployment insurance. You're just out here. You say, yeah, I'll do it.
Sure. Actually, as an example, I pay the taxes, but I'm not allowed to be an immigrant. So is the worst deal that you get as a businessman in the U.S. that's non-alien business person. So you do business there, you pay your taxes, so you're not benefiting from the welfare. You're a contributor,
yeah. But
you're not allowed to go there. I mean, you have to go through a very difficult process to apply for immigrant status.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
So right now, it's the worst of the both options in this deal.
Well, I mean, certainly, I will tell just one final thing. I mean, obviously, I'm the grandson of immigrants. Of course, obviously, we immigrants, we Jews, were kept out because we were socialists. And obviously, a disproportionate number of Jews brought communism and socialism to the U.S., just like my mother did. That was why they said, no, we can't let the Jews in. They're a bunch of Marxists. And they were right. The racial profiling was valid. Basically, it was true, although, of course, Mises came as well, and he wasn't a socialist, so he benefited us. So it was a mixed bag. So therefore, my heart is definitely with the immigrants. And again, it actually is true, although maybe it's a slightly absurd statement, but I believe it's worth making, as Ben Powell and Brian Kaplan and others have pointed out, these economists have pointed out that if you actually think of a cab driver in a poor country versus in a rich country, if you think of all the capital that's waiting for these workers to
take over. If they just moved, and if we had flexible wage rates, then we could possibly double the output of the world. And amazing. They say, well, imagine there's a margin of error on that, and we could only increase the output of the world by 50% by opening up the immigration gates. And it's a very simple point, but I think a very striking one. And actually, of course, to imagine how it would work, we'd have to have the welfare give up, and we'd have to have flexible wage rates. But it's really a very rational plan for the world to allow the immigrants in. On that note, I'm sure I've worn out my welcome. I thank you very much for your rapt attention about My Mommy is a Comedy Odyssey, and I appreciate all your good questions. Thanks very much.